So, good morning everyone. Welcome to my talk. First of all, I also want to thank you for the invitation, Yehuda, and also UNIT for the help with the organizational stuff. It's my first time to Israel. I arrived yesterday evening, but my first impression was already excellent, so I enjoy very much being here, so thank you. Okay, this talk is about the security of TLS 1.3 and a different protocol, which is called QUIC, against the weakness in an encryption scheme, which is called PKCS1 version 1.5. So here's again an overview over different TLS versions. In this talk, I will talk about TLS 1.3, which is going to be finalized, hopefully, in this year. The current version of TLS is TLS 1.2, which was standardized in 2008. TLS 1.2 is the most recent version of TLS, but this doesn't mean that everybody uses this most recent version. So even if this was published about 8 years ago, the most widely used version of TLS is 1.0, which is supported by nearly 100% of all web servers. And even the old-fashioned SSL versions, which are actually considered insecure today, are still used by a surprisingly large number of web servers. There are two points that I would like to make on this slide. The first one is that it's very common for a web server to support more than one version. So a typical good configured web server which wants to maximize compatibility with clients would use TLS version 1.0, would offer TLS version 1.2, 1.1, 1.0, all these TLS versions here, okay. And once TLS 1.3 is finalized and will be published, it will be very likely that the server will additionally offer version 1.3 and do this in parallel with all these older versions. And the second thing, which is very surprising, is that, well, 100% of web servers, or nearly 100%, are using TLS 1.0, which is from 1999. And just to give some example how old this is. Yeah, 1999 was the year when we were still using Windows 98, second edition. Yeah, Windows 98 second edition is from 1999. So imagine how computers looked like in 1999, imagine how cars or mobile phones looked like in 1999, but we are still using a nearly 100% the TLS protocol, which is back from that time. This means that updating or replacing a security protocol in practice takes a very, very long time. Yeah? So 16 to 17 years after publication of TLS 1.0. And this means that if we want to design a new protocol like TLS 1.3, then we should design this protocol very carefully and analyze its security from all different conceivable angles. I need two preliminaries before I can describe the attack. So the first one is the encryption scheme with the beautiful name RSA PKCS1 version 1.5 encryption, or just RSA encryption for short in this talk. And this is the most frequently used key transport mechanism in all TLS versions before TLS 1.3. And if you're familiar with the RSA encryption scheme, then this scheme is very easy to explain. It's just a simple textbook RSA encryption, except that the encrypted message must have a certain structure. Structure means that the message is prepended with a couple of random bytes to make encryption probabilistic, plus a couple of constants. And we say that the ciphertext is valid if it contains a correctly padded message. PKCS1 version 1.5 encryption is not used anymore on TLS 1.3, and there are many different reasons for abandoning this encryption scheme in the new TLS version. The first one is clearly that it doesn't provide forward security, which is the security property that we want to have from modern security protocols. But I guess most cryptographers would agree that a second very good reason for removing this encryption scheme from the standard is that it's vulnerable to a classical attack, chosen ciphertext attack by Daniel Bleichenbacher from Crypto 98. And of course, the obvious question now is it sufficient to remove this encryption scheme from the standard to protect against its weaknesses? There's of course a seemingly obvious answer. How can an encryption scheme be insecure, or a protocol like TLS be insecure against weaknesses of a protocol like PKCS1 encryption that it doesn't use? Okay, apparently it should be secure, but it is not, at least in practice. The second preliminary that I need is Bleichenbacher's attack, which basically works as follows. We have an attacker. The attacker receives as input a PKCS ciphertext, and the attacker has access to an oracle, and this oracle helps the attacker to distinguish valid from invalid ciphertext. So this means that the attacker may create new ciphertexts, which may either be valid or invalid, submit this ciphertext to the oracle, and the oracle responds whether the ciphertext was valid or not. Bleichenbacher now describes an algorithm which shows how an attacker is able to recover the message which is encrypted in this given target ciphertext here from the response of the oracle. In practice, this oracle is usually provided by a web server which responds, for example, with an error message if a given ciphertext is invalid. So this is what SSL implementations did in 1998 when Bleichenbacher published his attack. And so then TLS was fixed, so there was a special, there were several countermeasures were introduced, and the standard mentioned that an attacker should not be able to distinguish valid from invalid ciphertext, but of course there are many techniques and tricks that may enable an attacker to allow this, for instance, by checking the timing that the server needs to process a ciphertext. So it might, for example, take longer to process an invalid ciphertext, for instance, because a Java exception is thrown or something like this, than an invalid ciphertext, than a valid ciphertext. And Bleichenbacher's attack is also slightly stronger than what is shown here on this slide. So it does not only allow to recover the message, which is encrypted in this PKCS ciphertext, but actually it allows to perform a full RSA secret key operation. This means that it, on the one hand, of course, enables the attacker to decrypt ciphertext, but it enables the attacker also to do other things, like, for instance, to compute RSA signatures. Yeah, and there are many examples of Bleichenbacher attacks or of papers which leverage the techniques of Bleichenbacher to attack different protocols and schemes in the literature. So starting with Bleichenbacher's original paper in Crypto 98, there was a follow-up paper by Klima, Rosa, and Pokorny, again on TLS. And then there was a huge gap here. So for many years, we thought that we would have an understanding how to implement PKCS1 version 1.5 encryption correctly. And this led other protocol designers of other protocols beyond TLS to the belief that they can also use this encryption scheme in their protocols. So what happened is that we looked at the XML encryption standard, which is a different standard, and it turned out that this is completely insecure. So the weakness is in the standard. And so there was an example of a Bleichenbacher attack on XML encryption, which is impossible to prevent from any application which follows the standard. A similar issue was discovered by De Gabriele et al. On the EMV protocol, which is used for credit card payments in Europay, MasterCard, Visa. And then people started looking at TLS again. So we had this great paper by Badu et al. From Crypto 2012, who first of all improved Bleichenbacher's attack in several ways and also gave many practical examples of vulnerable devices and implementations. Then there was a super cool paper by Zhang et al. From ACMCCS 2014. What they did is they took a state-of-the-art OpenSSL implementations which implemented all known countermeasures against Bleichenbacher's attack, so which was considered to be secure, but they considered the use of this implementation in a new setting. So they considered a cloud setting where we have virtual machines and we have an attacker which runs a virtual machine on the same physical hardware as the machine of the target. So and then by using clever cache timing attacks, so they had some kind of some physical interface to the victim, they were able to break even the OpenSSL implementations, which implemented all known countermeasures against the attack. Yes, and then we have this paper here by Meyer et al. From Usenet Security, which again invented new clever tricks to perform timing attacks. Okay. So the point that I want to make on this slide is that it makes sense to analyze protocols, and in particular protocols which are as important as TLS 1.3, under the assumption that Bleichenbacher-like attacks remain a realistic threat for these protocols. So this was my slide that I've showed, for example, at ReWorld Crypto this year in January. It's not up to date anymore. Does anyone have an idea what is missing here? Except for Nimrod, maybe? Drone, exactly. So. this is how the slide looks like. So this means that this is about how the slide should look like today. This means that the assumption makes sense. Okay, there are examples, and there will be Bleichenbacher's attacks over and over again. So let's now have a look at how TLS 1.3 will typically be used in practice. So we consider a scenario where we have a web server. The server implements the new version, TLS 1.3, and it also offers some old version for backwards compatibility, like, for example, TLS 1.0 here. And in this example here, the server uses the same RSA certificates for both protocol versions. This is a standard setting. So actually, all servers do it this way. But for now, it's an assumption, and I will explain later why this assumption is very reasonable, yeah? Beyond the fact that all servers use it. Okay. And then we have two different kinds of users. The first one are smart users, clever users who follow the literature on TLS attacks, who have seen Tyler's slides on recent TLS attacks. Yeah? And she's aware of the weaknesses of TLS versions before 1.3, and therefore she uses exclusively TLS 1.3, okay? Only the newest version. And of course, we have these old diehard users like Ralph here, and Ralph is not so clever, and he uses this old TLS 1.3 version. Now, by the assumption that we've made, assume that this connection is insecure, okay? But at least we would expect, and we want to hope, that at least this connection here is secure, okay? So before I can explain the attack, let us have a closer look at the current state of TLS 1.3. So TLS 1.3 is not yet finished, but what I'm going to show you now is one of the relatively stable parts in the specification, okay? So we have this web server here, which implements TLS 1.3. And Lisa now sends two messages. The first one is a client hello message, which essentially contains a random nonce. The second one is a contribution to a Diffie-Hellman key, an elliptic curve Diffie-Hellman key share. The server responds with a server hello message, server key share, which again contributes to a Diffie-Hellman key, and a certificate. So the important point on this slide here is now that all these messages here are computed independently of the secret key of the server. Okay, anyone can compute these messages here. And that's because this is just a Diffie-Hellman share, this is just a Diffie-Hellman share, these are random nonces, and the certificate is public information. At some point, of course, the Diffie-Hellman shares have to be authenticated, and this is done by using the certificate verify message, which is basically an RSA signature computed by the server over all previous messages. And then the handshake finishes with the two finished messages, which are again independent of the long-term secret of the server. Okay, these messages depend on the Diffie-Hellman key, which is established here, but the secret RSA key is not required to compute these messages. Okay, now I can explain the attack. So the attack is a man-in-the-middle attack, which means that the attacker is able to modify, drop, inject, and so on, in arbitrary messages. Okay, the attacker controls the network communication between Lisa and the server. And now Lisa establishes a TLS 1.3 session, and the attacker responds with all these messages that can be computed without knowing the secret key. Okay, next, the attacker has to compute the certificate verify message. This is the difficult part because it depends on the secret key. And here, the attacker uses Bleichenbacher's attack to compute the required signature. Okay, so this is because Bleichenbacher's attack does not only enable an attacker to decrypt ciphertext, but also to compute signatures. Okay. Essentially, the attack allows the attacker to perform an RSA secret key operation, which is sufficient to compute signatures.
So they're using the same key both for signatures and for encryption?
This is the assumption that I'm making right now.
Okay.
Yeah, and I will comment on it later. I have a slide for this one. I guess I know what you have in mind, encrypt only, sign only certificates, and I have a slide for this.
Okay,
so... yeah, and finally, the finished messages, which are again computable by the attacker. So at the end of this attack, the adversary was able to impersonate the server successfully against Lisa using the weakness of TLS 1.0, even though Lisa uses only the state-of-the-art TLS 1.3 encryption scheme. And this means that TLS, somewhat surprisingly, is vulnerable to Bleichenbacher's attack, even though it doesn't even use PKCS1 version 1.5 encryption, in settings where the TLS 1.3 is used in parallel with older versions, okay, which is a very practical assumption.
You also need the Bleichenbacher
come back to be a very efficient version, right?
I'll also comment on that one. So right now, in principle, it's vulnerable. Okay, depends on how practical this is something that we should discuss, right? Okay, so the practical impact on TLS 1.0 is, I would say, rather limited in general. And the reason is that a typical example of a Bleichenbacher attack takes very long, like hours or sometimes, for some example, maybe several days and millions of connections. There are maybe some artificial examples like machine-to-machine communication where this may be harmful, but certainly not for users that use a web browser. Okay, nobody opens a web page and waits for a couple of days until the page is loaded. But it still shows that backwards compatibility is something that must be considered, which it is important in practice. And of course, there can be future improvements to Bleichenbacher's attack or new examples of side channels which allow more efficient attacks. So in a sense, right now, the impact is rather limited, but maybe we are just only one or two ideas away from a practical attack. Okay? And finally, here's Drown again. Okay, what Drown did, and Nimrod is going to explain this in much more detail in his talk, is that what they show is, I'm not sure if they made it explicit in their paper, but using their techniques, one is able to forge a signature in a single minute using only simple hardware, okay, and just a similar CPU. The idea behind this is that what the authors of Drown did is they combined their techniques with a specific weakness in OpenSSL, which was present in OpenSSL in all OpenSSL versions from 1998 to early 2015, and many web servers were vulnerable. Okay, so in principle, the impact of the attack is rather limited, but there are many examples where this, and this may change very quickly. Yeah, and Drown is an example. Okay, so given that the attack on TLS 1.0, the attack on TLS 1.0 is somewhat limited, okay, it might make sense to consider the security of other protocols against this type of attacks. And we also looked at the QUIC protocol, which was proposed by Google for low latency key exchange. So zero round attempt key exchange is that's how Thaler called it. And this protocol is now discontinued by Google. So they are planning to switch over to TLS 1.3. And there are many different reasons for doing this. And I talked to Adam Langley from Google at Real World Crypto. One reason why they're going to change this is the attack that I'm going to show you in this slide here. Okay, we consider again the same scenario. We have a server which offers the new QUIC protocol and for backwards compatibility some other old protocol. We have a user like Lisa who uses only exclusively the secure QUIC protocol, and we have a man-in-the-middle attacker. And now the difference to TLS 1.3 is that for QUIC, the attacker is able to mount his attack long before Lisa establishes her connections, okay? Which means that this can make the attack much more practical, because if this step here takes hours or days or weeks or maybe even months, okay, it doesn't care, yeah, the attacker gets a value which is sufficient to impersonate the server later towards Lisa, okay? So this means that retrieving one signature for QUIC using a Bleichenbacher's attack is essentially equivalent to learning the secret key of the server. Okay, and then maybe it might make sense to invest a couple of weeks or so to mount this attack. And so this is the situation for QUIC. And the difference to TLS 1.3 was that the TLS 1.3 handshake starts with hello messages, and these hello messages are part of the signature which is sent here. Okay, they are signed here. And this means that the attacker has to wait for this hello message here. Only then is able to compute a matching signature and can only then mount the attack. Okay, so on TLS 1.3, the attack is only practical if we have a very fast Bleichenbacher oracle like the one provided by Drown, for example. Okay, so now to your question, yeah, how can we prevent these attacks? It turns out that it's surprisingly difficult to prevent it. So first of all, there is in theory a super simple and a very efficient solution to prevent it, which is called key separation. And I'm pretty sure that Yehuda teaches this concept, maybe not explicitly, but at least implicitly in his class. Yeah? And key separation means that we have one certificate, one RSA certificate. This is the green one, which is used only for TLS version 1.3. And we have a different one, which contains an independently generated RSA key, which is used only for TLS 1.0. And we may hope now that Lisa only accepts the green certificate because it belongs to a TLS 1.3 session. Okay? In this case, the attacker would not be able to make use of this Bleichenbacher weakness here, okay? Because it uses an independent key, and in this case, he's able to simulate this Bleichenbacher oracle himself there, okay? So the problem is that X549 certificates do not contain any information about the protocol version. And this means that the attacker can simply take the orange certificate, which belongs to TLS 1.0, present it to Lisa as if it was a TLS 1.3 certificate, and the same attack works again as before. Okay? So that's the first issue. There are several further difficulties that we have to face if we want to prevent this attack. So first of all, key separation is not supported, not by servers. So we looked at the Apache Mod SSL implementation and at the Nginx web server, and both these servers do not allow users to configure two different certificates for different protocol versions or for different protocols. Okay, so, and the same for browsers. Browsers do not check anything in this direction. So this has to be implemented first. Okay. Second, certificates cost money. So in particular, an extended validation certificates cost somewhere in the ballpark of, I would say, 1,000 shekels or so per year. And so currently, we have a server operator would buy a single certificate and use it for all protocol versions. And if he wants to do this key separation principle properly, then you would have to buy one certificate for TLS 1.0, one for 1.1, 1.2, 1.3, and so on. And if he wants to do it completely correctly, then actually he would have to buy different certificates for different cipher suites in TLS. Okay? So, and this is something, maybe it might be possible to convince server operators to do this, but they will not be able to convince their management to invest that much money only in security. Okay? So, that's the second issue. Then X549 certificates actually provide something that we could in principle use here to prevent this attack. Namely, X549 supports so-called sign-only certificates and encrypt-only certificates, which basically means that a sign-only certificate can only be used to create signatures, and encrypt-only certificates can only be used for TLS cipher suites that use RSA encryption. And this would in principle a clean and simple solution and protection against this attack. The problem is a browser would have to check whether it receives a certificate which is made for sign-only or encrypt-only. And browsers currently do not do this. And I talked to a developer of Mozilla. Unfortunately, I don't remember his name, at the Tron workshop this year in San Diego. And they said, no, we do not check this in our browser. And we also won't check this ever because this would cause usability and compatibility. We can't do this.
Also, many people are using Diffie-Hellman cipher suites in TLS 1.2, and they will not work with encrypt only.
Yeah, exactly. That's also a good point. Right, yeah. But that's maybe one of the reasons, actually, why they do not want to check this, okay? Because this would break compatibility with their browsers. So, yeah. So there may be people who have an encrypt-only certificate, but configure Diffie-Hellman cipher suite for formal security and so on, and then this would not work. Exactly, yeah. Okay, so to summarize, I guess I've been much faster than I planned to be. First of all, I want to say that removing RSA encryption from TLS 1.3 is an excellent decision. It was a bit late, 16, 17, 18 years after Bleichenbacher's attack. But it's still the right decision. Yeah? Unfortunately, this is not enough to protect completely against its weaknesses. The good news is that TLS 1.3 is somewhat more robust against this kind of attacks than other protocols, like for example, QUIC, because a signature is not equivalent to a secret key. And this also shows that it's a good idea to sign ephemeral values. So this has been discussed intensively in the process of the standardization of TLS 1.0, whether signatures should be pre-computable by servers or not. And this result somehow shows that it's a good idea to make signatures not pre-computable, but to make them dependent on values received from the client. And then it turns out that key separation, which is a simple and theoretically clean approach to prevent such attacks, is surprisingly difficult to implement in practice. So one thing that I'm currently working on is the IETF has invited me to a meeting where I can present more or less the same talk again. And I'm hoping that I will be able to convince them that future versions of X509 will somehow enable the inclusion of different public keys for different protocols and different protocol versions. And of course, we would also have to kind of convince server implementers and browser developers to support us as well. Okay, so that's the end of my talk. Thank you very much.